If I've told you once, I've told you a thousand times. Each of us has, what, do you think I was talking about you?
No, I've heard myself say it.
Well, most of us have said that or had it said to us at some point in our lives. Of course, in the majority of cases, it hasn't been a thousand times. It might just have felt that way to your mother when she kept telling you to pick up your dirty laundry off of your bedroom floor. Numbers are fascinating. They can be precise or they can be symbolic. And as we take a look at Revelation 7 this morning, we're going to learn just how symbolic they can be. I hope you'll stay tuned to learn more. Welcome to all who have gathered for worship in person and all of you who have gathered online. We're glad that you're with us. My name is Jeff Loach. I'm the pastor here at St. Paul's. And if you're not with us this morning, you're missing out because you could stay for coffee if you wanted to after the service. Just join us outside and we'll be glad to have you. Feel free to hit the like, the subscription, notification bells, all those things on YouTube so we can keep in touch with each other. And the connection card is available at stpaulsmobleton.ca/connect for any of us to make use of. I want to say a special welcome to Peter, who has joined us at the piano again this morning, is substituting for Paul. Paul is at Graceland. I don't know if he is doing Elvis impersonations or if he is, but I believe he's on some kind of business at Graceland in Memphis this weekend. Speaking of Paul, his last Sunday with us will be April 24th, if all goes according to plan. And that day we intend to celebrate his ministry among us, so I hope you will be here to offer some encouraging words that day. And next week, as coffee officially comes back to the gym, we're going to celebrate Harold MacDonald for his many years of service as a trustee for the congregation. To be clear, I don't think Harold is impersonating Elvis in Memphis this weekend. I think he's probably watching at home. Hi, Harold. And as the elders resume a rotation of greeting you in the lobby today, I want to pay tribute to Irma Evans, who, with the exception of two or three Sundays, welcomed you at the door each Sunday we were open from the beginning of the pandemic until last Sunday. And her assistance has been a mighty help to me and to us. And so, Irma, thank you for being such a trooper. Yes. Listen to that, Irma. That's for you. Praise the Lord. We're going to worship together next Sunday, celebrating Palm Sunday, and on Good Friday as well, marking the crucifixion, and then celebrate the resurrection on Easter Day when we will celebrate the Lord's Supper together as well. And I hope you'll make a point of coming and being with us in community on those days. Psalm 100, verses 1 and 2 say, "Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with songs of joy." Let's worship the Lord together. Please stand. We'll begin by singing "He Reigns."
The song.
hear the word of God this morning, first from the 49th chapter of the book of Isaiah. This is what the Lord says. At just the right time, I will respond to you. On the day of salvation, I will help you. I will protect you and give you to the people as my covenant with them. Through you, I will reestablish the land of Israel and assign it to its own people again. I will say to the prisoners, come out in freedom, and to those in darkness, come into the light. They will be my sheep grazing in green pastures and on hills that were previously bare. They will neither hunger nor thirst. The searching sun will not reach them anymore. For the Lord in his mercy will lead them. He will lead them beside cool waters, and I will make my mountains into level paths for them. The highways will be raised above the valleys. See, my people will return from far away, from lands to the north and the west, and from as far as south as Egypt. Sing for joy, O heavens, rejoice, O earth. Burst into song, O mountains, for the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on them in their suffering. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we praise you for your compassionate help in times of suffering, whenever they befall your people. You are a loving and caring God. You made the world and everything in it, and though the world is yours, you still inhabit the praises of your people. You long to be in relationship with us, and we seek to be in relationship with you. And yet we confess that too often we put our own obstacles in place to stunt our relationship with you. We sin and fall short of your glory. We place our trust in that which will spoil or fade instead of anchoring our faith in you, on whom we can always rely. We knowingly do things and think things that become potholes, even sinkholes, in the road toward holiness. Forgive us. Have mercy on us. Put a new and right spirit within each of us and place us back on the smooth road to you through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. Remind us that your steadfast love never ceases, that your mercies never come to an end. Thank you, Lord, that they are new every morning and your faithfulness is great. We thank you for your sustaining grace in the midst of sickness and challenge. We pray for those we know who have fallen ill with COVID and are recovering. We pray for those who are frustrated by a lack of employment or an employment that does not use the gifts and talent that people have to the full. We pray for parents and children. Strained relationships from times of COVID and other things. We ask you for grace in the midst of those situations. We pray for those who travel, for those likewise who are yet paralyzed with fear, afraid to leave their homes. Comfort and protect them, we pray, and give them delight and courage. We pray for peace in our world and for your justice to be meted with fairness and equity. We pray for the end of all global conflicts and especially think of the people of Ukraine, forgotten though they may have been in the news for a day or two because of a spat among the rich and famous at the Oscars. Sovereign God, we pray that as we listen for your word today, we will be strengthened and renewed. We admit that Revelation is not an easy book for us to comprehend, but in the midst of that, we know we can trust the one who has fought the good fight and won the race for us by his atoning death on the cross. Give us clarity of mind and heart as we await your word for us, illumined by your Holy Spirit. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the responsibilities of the elder on the door as she gets up and walks out it, I don't know whether that wasn't a cue, is to count how many people show up to worship on Sunday. And you might think, why do we do that? Well, the denominational officer, for some reason, asks us to keep a count on how many people are here on an average Sunday through the year. Not that they do anything with those figures, but display them for all to see. But more importantly, I think, seeing that number in print helps keep me grounded. Pastors are notorious number inflators. Maybe it's our optimistic outlook, or maybe it's got something to do with those conversations we have with colleagues that inevitably turn to how successful things are in the church. The consultants always tell us that we can't base our success solely on the number of people who show up on Sunday, especially in this era of increased online presence. But we still like to know how many people are coming to worship each week. Now, somebody could ask me, how many people were here last Sunday? And I might toss out a number, and it would probably be a little higher than the number that the elder recorded. I tried a test of that this week. Somebody did ask me, and I threw out a number, and then I went and looked in the green book, and I was actually only off by one. I was higher, but I was only off by one. But it gives me a good dose of reality when I look in that little green folder each week. Sometimes it is better than I thought, but why do I tell you all this? Well, in Revelation 7, John's vision continues, and he hears a number, and he sees a vast crowd. But in John's case, the number was lower than the size of the throng that he witnessed. Now, there's got to be a reason for this. We're going to learn as we read the chapter. Remember, this comes hot in the heels of that terrifying picture that was painted for us in chapter 6 of those four horses and riders bringing heresy and war and famine and death. And the question we left off with at the end of chapter 6 was, who is able to survive? And chapter 7 gives us the answer. Let's read it together. I gotta jump in right at the first three words, though. Then I saw. We need to be careful not to put too much emphasis on the then, because it makes us think that this is chronological. And it may not actually be chronological. This may not have happened immediately after, even though I said hard on the heels of. It was certainly for us hard on the heels of. These visions are not necessarily, or these vignettes, chronological. Then I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds, so they did not blow on the earth or the sea or even on any tree. Now, these angels are holding back all the winds at God's command. And that was a big deal, because in pagan culture in the first century, there was an individual god for each direction of the wind. So there was a god for the north wind and a god for the south wind and so on and so forth. Here, we're seeing a picture of the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ having control over all the winds. In preparation, I suppose, for the calamity that was described near the end of chapter 6. But we should also know, this is not, you know, the four corners of the earth. This is not a proof text for flat earth, right? There are some folks who kind of want to use this as a way to say, oh, the earth is flat. Well, no. The idiom four corners probably just refers to the four compass points. Now, Hal Lindsey is a name you will not hear me invoke very often, but he wrote a lot of books in his day about what he thought the end times were going to be like, and he read this to mean that climate change was a harbinger of the end times, but I'm not even sure we can read that into the text. Verse 2. And I saw another angel coming up from the east, carrying the seal of the living God. And he shouted to the four angels who had been given power to harm the land and sea, "Wait, don't harm the land or the sea or the trees until we have placed the seal of God on the foreheads of his servants." So God is preventing the winds from blowing in judgment until his servants have been protected. And how many are there? Who are they? Verse 4, "And I heard how many were marked with the seal of God. 144,000 were sealed from all the tribes of Israel." And then we get a chart. The Bible actually, in most Bibles, it'll just have the name of the tribe, ...... 12,000. But if you look at it online, it actually throws a chart at you. So, from Judah, 12,000. From Reuben, 12,000. From Gad, 12,000. From Asher, 12,000. From Naphtali, 12,000. From Manasseh, 12,000. From Simeon, 12,000. From Levi, 12,000. From Issachar, 12,000. From Zebulun, 12,000. From Joseph, 12,000. From Benjamin, 12,000. Now, the seal of God was a stamp of ownership and approval. And what was on that seal? Well, if we read a little ahead to Revelation chapter 14, verse 1, it says this, "Then I saw the Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him were 144,000 who had his name and his Father's name written on their foreheads." So if God's name is on your forehead, guess what can't be there? That is the mark of the beast. We'll get to that when that topic arises in a little while, as in weeks. So we have here a line of demarcation between God's people and the world. It's much like the blood that was placed on the doorposts in the book of Exodus, which denoted the households that would not be visited by the seven plagues. Those plagues decimated the Egyptians, but it touched neither the Israelites nor even their animals. The seal of God here in Revelation 7 would do the same thing. It would rescue the faithful of God from the wrath to come. But is this 144,000 number to be taken literally? Well, the Jehovah's Witnesses think so. And conveniently for them, they think they will all be Jehovah's Witnesses. They have this idea that exactly 144,000 people from the first century to the end of time will be glorified and that they will all be JWs. Now, again, Hal Lindsey, twice in one sermon, write that down. No, actually, don't write it down. He believed that the 144,000 were Jewish evangelists who were converted after the rapture of the church. A number of Christians think this number should be taken literally, but this really makes no sense at all for a number of reasons, one of which is that there have been far more than 144,000 Christians who have lived since the ascension of Jesus to this day. And there have been more than 144,000 who have been martyred for their testimony about Jesus since the ascension. This is the first time in the book that John hears a number of the servants of God. The other time is in chapter 9, verse 16. And there, the number is 200 million. Just as he hears about a lion and sees a lamb, so he hears about 144,000 and sees a multitude. Now, I think we need to see this number, as so many in Scripture, in a figurative light. 12,000 times 12 tribes is 144,000. But if you think of the 12 as the number, as we saw earlier, as the number of the tribes of Israel, the number of the apostles representing Jewish and Gentile believers, and if you take 1,000 to mean a lot, then what you're looking at is 144,000 symbolizing a vast number of followers of Jesus. What's more, they cannot just be Jewish believers, even though the tribes of Israel are listed here. And there's some reasons for that. At the time of John's writing, all but the tribe of Judah and a smattering of the tribe of Ephraim were lost. They had faded into history. Now, could God raise up members of the other tribes? I think so, of course, but I don't think that's really what he's meaning here. And my doubt arises from the fact that we have in that list of 12 one missing tribe and one and not two included half-tribes. That is, we've included Manasseh, but not Ephraim, who was one of Joseph's sons. And the tribe of Dan is omitted. So why is Dan omitted and why is Manasseh included and not Ephraim? Well, we're getting into the weeds here, but some speculate that these two were omitted because they had engaged in some specific sinful and idolatrous activity. There were some, in fact, who suggested that the Antichrist would arise from the tribe of Dan. But if you look back in Genesis 49:17, when Jacob is blessing his sons, says this: Dan will be a snake beside the road, a poisonous viper along the path that bites the horse's hooves so its rider is thrown off. Doesn't sound very nice, does it? And yet, a verse before that, in verse 16 of Genesis 49, it says, Dan will govern his people like any other tribe in Israel. Confusing. It's not clear that Dan would not play a role among the other tribes. And if Jesus viewed the Samaritans as well as he did, as kindly as he did, radical though that view was, why didn't the tribe of Ephraim, from which the Samaritans descended, get included? Maybe they were omitted because the idea here was to paint a picture of a pure people of God. Although I cannot see how all those tribes would each represent purity. Judah was listed first because of the Lion of Judah, who was the lamb that was slain. The rest are in pretty much birth order, but Dan was omitted. Manasseh, one of Joseph's sons, was included. One other thing. This list reads like a census. And censuses were usually taken in preparation for a military conflict. Let's find out how many soldiers we got. So 12 battalions of 1,000 men each. But in order to serve in the military in those days in the Holy Land, you had to be a virgin male. So that suggests that a literal reading of this list would mean that only 144,000 Jewish virgin men would be given the seal of God, leaving the faithful Gentiles, the married men, and all the women to suffer. Doesn't sound quite like what God had in mind, I don't think. And all this leads me to believe that this listing must be figurative and not literal. And you can't compromise on that, because if you compromise on the literality or figurative validity, we'll make that a word today, of the number 144,000, then you would have to do the same with the tribes as well. So verses 4 to 8 are really talking about the seal of God being given to a vast number from the Jewish and Gentile followers of Jesus. And this makes sense in light of verse 9. After this, he says, I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. This is that figurative 144,000 from earlier, the redeemed church. They were clothed in white robes, symbolic of those who had overcome, the martyrs, and held palm branches in their hand. Now, palm branches were symbols of deliverance from slavery, as at the Feast of Tabernacles for the Jewish people, or for any military or military-like triumph, like the triumphal entry on Palm Sunday that we'll celebrate next week. And they were shouting with a great roar, Salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and from the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living beings, and they fell before the throne with their faces to the ground and worshiped God. They sang, Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength belong to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the 24 elders asked me, Who are these who are clothed in white? Where did they come from? And I said to him, Sir, you are the one who knows. And that's the right answer. Right? This is a pedagogical technique where you would ask, you know, a question for which you already know the answer. Then he said to me, These are the ones who died in the great tribulation. So we have a beautiful picture here again of heavenly worship. But don't overlook this. That beautiful singing of God's praise took place among those who had died in the tribulation. Last week, our passage focused on the four horses and riders who brought heresy and war and famine and death. And it ended with the question, who is able to survive? Even among those who did not survive, who died standing up for the cause of Jesus, the people sang. This is one of the reasons why we never gave up singing at any time during the pandemic. It was no fun at all trying to sing with a mask on, I'm sure. But if we hadn't been singing, we might as well just lock the doors and you could have watched me gas on for an hour from home. Because it just doesn't feel the same when you cannot sing the praises of our God. A sermon is an edifying act of worship, but it seems low on context, hollow, if you will, if we don't sing as well. Singing God's praise gives strength for the journey. Singing God's praise gives us joy amid our sorrow. Singing God's praise gives us hope when life seems hopeless. And these people were doing all the singing. They were the ones who faced those horses and riders. These were the people who gave their lives because they knew, echoing the Apostle Paul, that to live is Christ and to die is what? Gain. Sisters and brothers in Christ, whatever we may face in this life, be it suffering great or small, don't give up. Don't give in. Don't capitulate. Sing. Sing. Here we have one of the few references in the book of Revelation to the concept of the great tribulation, a time of testing. When we went through our series on heaven last year, I mentioned that this concept often gets twisted by those who would have the timing of the last things on earth fit their schedule. That there will be some period of testing, of trial, of persecution of believers, there can be no doubt. But a popular doctrine, one that is less than 200 years old, would somehow have it fit into the concept of a rapture, where the church will be rescued and taken to be with God before things get really ugly here on earth. But there is very little biblical support for that concept. But what is the Great Tribulation? Well, some say that it could have been the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Some say it could have been the fall of the Roman Empire. We're not exactly sure what the Great Tribulation will involve. But we can be certain, simply by reading history, if nothing else, that followers of Jesus have suffered, will suffer, for their testimony about the gospel. The New Testament writers make it absolutely plain that if you're a follower of Jesus, at some point in this life, you are going to suffer for your faith. And that suffering may well involve a concentrated period of time. We don't know when, and we dare not try to predict it based on other events. All we can do is be ready for it. And I'll say more about that in a few minutes. Carrying on, it says, they have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb and made them white. If ever there was an oxymoron in the Bible, I think this is it. They have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb and made them white. Of course, it's symbolic. The blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin, Scripture tells us, so that when sin taints us, faith in Christ who died for our sins washes us and makes us white as snow. But the theme of this chapter itself seems oxymoronic because the theme is triumph through martyrdom. We win with death. That's humanly incomprehensible. But how like Jesus that is. Jesus triumphed over death. How? By death. He stamped out the power of sin by dying for it. Verse 15, that is why, that is because they've washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb, they stand in front of God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple. The pagans had their emperor worship and they'd go and do their thing from time to time. But here, the worship of the living God is day and night. And he who sits on the throne will give them shelter. They will never again be hungry or thirsty. They dealt with the black horse of famine, but no more. They will never be scorched by the heat of the sun. These promises we heard in Isaiah 49, that one is echoed in Psalm 121. For the Lamb is on the throne, again denoting the deity of Jesus. The Lamb on the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of life-giving water, and God will wipe every tear from their eyes. There's a little hope when you need it most. We hear that a lot about at funerals, right? God will wipe away every tear. We don't often see the context for it. Earlier I mentioned about being ready for what can be assured we will be a season of suffering. But before I talk about that, let's be clear about one thing. The only way to deal with suffering is by faith in Jesus Christ. One way or another, suffering's going to happen. For all believers, well, for believers, it will be at the hands of evil people through heresy, war, famine, death, as we learn in chapter 6. For those who are not followers of Jesus, that suffering will occur at the judgment. There's a lot of people who think all you got to do is be good and God will have you. But here's the problem with that. We can't be good enough. Oh, we try. We're nice people. We give to charity. We contribute to the community. We might even drive the speed limit, though I doubt it. We might even go to church. But nothing we can do is good enough to atone for our own sins. And since God can't look on sin, all our good works do us no good when the final judgment comes. We can't pull it off. Only one person who ever lived can pull it off, and that's Jesus, fully God, fully human, who lived a sinless life and then died on the cross to pay the price for our sins, so that by faith we could receive God's righteousness. When we follow Jesus and trust him for our salvation, he imputes his righteousness upon us so that when God looks on us, all he sees is the sinless righteousness of Jesus. Then all the good things we do, and we should do good things, we're not doing them to appease God, but to please God. We do them in response to his work in our lives and in gratitude for the grace he has shown us in enabling us to believe that Jesus is our own personal Savior and Lord. So you can't be good enough, but you can trust the one who is good enough, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're a follower of Jesus, you need to gird yourself in preparation for what you will suffer. It's like preparing yourself for battle because you are preparing yourself for battle. When the Apostle Paul was closing his letter to the church in Ephesus, one of the churches that's listed in Revelation chapter 2, he gave them some sage advice that we do well to take for ourselves. This is Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 17. A final word. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in this time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So while the preppers are getting ready for the zombie apocalypse bug-out bags that they've got going and all the ammunition they can find and the canned goods stored away, we can ready ourselves with the belt of truth, with the body armor of God's righteousness, with the shoes of the gospel of peace, with the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. In other words, be ready for our time of tribulation by deepening your relationship with the Lord in every way possible. Read and study the Bible, not only in worship, but in a Life Connect group and on your own. Live a life of righteous discipline that makes you more like Jesus every day. Seek peace with all people in your daily activities. Live by faith and be brave, knowing that you are among those whom the Lord has chosen to be his faithful people. And share Jesus with others. Don't leave that to me. You can do it too. We who are among the multitude, that figurative 144,000, are in an army too. We're in the Lord's army. And make no mistake, we are fighting a spiritual battle. And we all know that despite all the superhero movies, there is no battle that is won alone. We are given a battalion with whom to fight, and that battalion is the church. Remember, the church isn't the building. The church is the people. We are the church, and we fight these battles together. We need each other. We need community. Even Jesus didn't undertake his ministry by himself. He had concentric circles of community with whom he did life and ministry. The three, Peter, James, and John, the 12 apostles, the 70, then larger groups beyond that. Some of them wanted to storm the temple. Some of them wanted to take down the Pharisees and Sadducees, and some of them wanted to take Jerusalem. But Jesus knew the battle was not for flesh and blood, nor for bricks and mortar. The battle is spiritual, and we need to wake up every morning and put on the full armor of God so that we can be ready to fight that spiritual battle. Of course, not every moment feels like a fight, at least I hope it doesn't. But every moment we should live in the light of God's love for us and God's love for the world, expressed most fully in Jesus, who died and rose again. And, as I mentioned earlier, we can sing. If you have a favorite, sing it loud and proud. This is where Christian music is so helpful in our walk with the Lord. We can't possibly remember the words of all the songs we love, but when you're in the car, you can put Life 100.3 on and listen to it, or you can get a good playlist from Apple Music or Spotify or YouTube or whatever streaming service you like. Pay attention to the lyrics and use them as praise, whether you're mopping the kitchen floor or sitting in heavy traffic or taking some time for personal devotion. Because one day, you are going to die. I am going to die. It might be a martyr's death. It might be a heart attack. You might get hit by a bus. But we're all going to die. Wouldn't you rather die with words of praise to God on your lips? And God can bring blessing from tragedy. A great historical example is that of William Wilberforce. Wilberforce was orphaned as a boy. Very sad story. His aunt and uncle were childless. Also a sad story. But those two circumstances brought Wilberforce into the home of his aunt and uncle to be cared for by them, and that enabled him to hear the preaching of John Newton, the slave trader turned abolitionist. And that set Wilberforce on the course to bring about the end of slavery, something he finally saw come to pass as he lay on his deathbed. Something started tragically and ended with victory. Christians can do great things, but we will not be shielded from suffering or even death. The great English preacher Charles Spurgeon once said, "It's impossible that any ill should happen to the one who is beloved of the Lord. Ill to him is no ill, but only good in mysterious form. Losses enrich us. Sickness is our medicine. Reproach is our honor. Death is our gain." We are a countercultural people. We will face hardship. But those who have the seal of God, having trusted Christ as Lord and Savior, will be spared the calamity that will be brought upon the world when the end comes. So I need to ask you this. Are you part of that figurative 144,000, that vast crowd, too great to count, who will stand before the throne and the Lamb in white robes and holding palm branches, singing that salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and from the Lamb? We don't know when the tribulation will come, but it will. And we don't know when it will end, but when it does, will you be aligned with Jesus? It's not enough to mentally assent to his existence. It's definitely not enough to just be a good person. You need to place faith and trust in him, that the work he accomplished on the cross brought you back into relationship with him as he trampled the power of sin in your life. And you need to do that today. Let's pray. Sovereign God, we don't know the day or the hour of the calamity that's to come, and we dare not try to predict it. All we can do is be ready. And we're grateful that you give us the opportunity to be ready by trusting the Lamb, our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us. We pray that any who are listening today in the room or online who have not taken that step will today place their trust in you, allowing Jesus to be Lord of their lives when they have to this point been their own masters. It's not an easy step, Lord, but you give us grace to believe. Receive now those who call upon your name. Hear their cries of repentance and forgiveness for their sins by the blood of the cross. Fill them with your Holy Spirit and make them thirst to do the work of your kingdom, drawing others to know and serve you. Father, give us all a song of praise on our lips. Help us to sing our way into your presence, whether we can carry a tune or not. And fit us for the day when our faith will be sight, when our suffering will be as nothing, when our death will be gain. Strengthen our faith to enable us to share your love with our friends, so that they will be added to that throng, that multitude of people too great to number. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you realize today that being good isn't good enough, if you decided by grace to give your life to Jesus Christ and serving him, would you let me know, either by conversation outside or through the connection card at stpaulsnobleton.ca/connect, so that I can provide you some encouragement. And if you have questions about today's message, feel free to be in touch by that same means, and I'll be glad to connect with you. We're going to sing an old gospel favorite that I hope is on your heart today, "When the Roll is Called Up Yonder."
Trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks.
had an update from one of our mission partners this week, Marie Enns, who leads Rescue Cambodia, a ministry to orphans and grannies in Cambodia. She reports that their goal has been reached of having all of their staff be Cambodian people, so that all of the people who minister to these children and senior women in Cambodia are themselves Cambodians. The ministry has a financial campaign going on right now, which I'm sure our mission team will be participating in, to raise money such that for the total to get $1,000 a day for a year to support the good work that Marie and her team are doing. And our gifts to God's mission continue to help this Christian ministry in a challenging place to bring the gospel to people in deep need. So thank you for your generous support. You can make a gift through the offering plate that's at the door as you go, or by mail, or through any of the electronic means listed on the screen. We're going to close by singing This Is Amazing Grace.
Above all.
Go into the world today, friends, as those who are singing of all that Jesus has done for us. Go in expectation that as his children, as those who have called upon the name of the Lord, you are part of that great throng that will be sealed with the name of the one who sits on the throne and of the Lamb. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with all of us and those we love today and always.